verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. We're ready to get back in our Father's Word, Revelation, the unveiling. It's important that you remember that. It's the next important thing, and perhaps the most important thing, is that you remember the first chapter and verse 10, that John was taken to the Lord's Day, which means the first day of the millennium, or you'll never understand this book of the unveiling. The uncovering. Uncovering what? God's truth. His letter to you, explaining. Now, in this fifth chapter, we found out there are seven seals, and no one was worthy to open them. That means to make the truth known. And finally, the Lamb slain, that is to say, after Christ's crucifixion, he was able to open them. And not only was he able to open them, as you're going to find out today, but he made them known to you if you have eyes to see and ears to hear. So, with that having been said, let's work our way right on down to the opening of the seals. Chapter 5, verse 9, and we've seen the Father's throne in this chapter. Here we go. Verse 9, a word of wisdom from our Father, and it reads, and they sung, these saints that were there by the altar, they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, whosoever will. In other words, those with free will had the privilege and the opportunity to accept that salvation on repentance and have eternal life. And we see here that many did overcome. Verse 10, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Now, of course, here again, it's directed back to the very saints themselves, the set-aside ones. And do you know where that's documented? It's documented in many places, but I'll simply run to one real quick. Chapter 20, verse 6. This is in the millennium, the 20th chapter being that millennium chapter. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power. That's the death of the soul. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And of course, 1,000 years being a millennium. This is reiterated again in Ezekiel chapter 44, beginning with about verse 23. For God's election during that same, speaking of that same millennium period. Okay, so, verse 11, as we continue back in chapter 5. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beast, or the living creatures, better translated, and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. In other words, an innumerable number. That's a Hebraism that means you could number them. It's a Hebraism for countlessness, I should say. Verse 12, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive, and let's count them now, to receive what? To receive power, one, and riches, two, and wisdom, three, and strength, four, and honor, five, and glory, six, and blessing, seven. Those seven spirits and the seven things received, even making you worthy of the same. I don't know how you're doing. Hey, think about it. Verse 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth. That is also another Hebraism that means all-inclusive. And such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying, blessed and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Bearing in mind, and it'll help you understand that statement, in that we are on the Lord's Day. And what happens on the first day of the millennium, the beginning of the Lord's Day? Remembering that one day with God is as 1,000 years with man, and 1,000 years is a millennium. Every knee will bow, as it is written. Verse 4, that's why they could all hear. 14. And the four beasts said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever. What these four beasts, or these four living creatures, when they say amen, what does amen mean? I mean, you've heard it all your life. You've even heard some people that have to ask for approval by saying, can I get an amen on that? Well, what does it mean? It means that is that. I could even say it a little different way. That's exactly how it is. That's exactly the truth. That's that. It always reminds me, in a sense, of a second witness to the sacred name, I am that I am. Chapter 6, we're going to get into the seals. I want to tell you something about the seals. The seals are not given in chronological order as far as time is concerned, but given in a chronological order for better understanding of what will fall upon the generation that would be living at the time and the time just before the millennium would begin, which is when? Now, the generation of the fig tree. So therefore, the seven trumps, what is a trumpet? What is the sound of a trumpet? It means action. The trumpets are in the exact chronological order of which events come to pass. But the seals are a teaching thing. Now, they will synchronize themselves by the sixth seal with the sixth trump, as well as the sixth vial, because that's when the Antichrist appears. 666. And that's real easy. We'll document that as we go through this great book. So I only wanted you to be aware, these seals, not given in chronological order as far as time is concerned, but given in a way that makes it simpler for you to understand. Chapter 6, verse 1. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four living creatures, beasts, saying, come and see. And we'll go through all four of these living creatures, and then they'll drop by the wayside. It was he. It wasn't one of the angels, but it was he that said, come and see. Verse 2. And I saw, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat on him had a bow. And a crown was given unto him. My word, he has a crown. He's a king. Yeah. And he went forth conquering and to conquer. Now, this, if there is any one verse that the whole deception can be wrapped up in, it's that one. Why? Well, because if we were to go to the 19th chapter, you'll find out that Christ himself arrives riding a white horse. However, he has quite an army with him. This dude will only have 7,000 with him. But the real Christ will have a crown, all right. It's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you will be changed instantly into a spiritual body. Now, in the fourth chapter, you noted that there was a bow. We'll call it a rainbow so you can get a visual picture perhaps a little better. That was around the throne, meaning the Shekinah glory was there. Now, do you know what this word bow here is in the Greek? It's toxin. And it's toxic, all right. It's a cheap fabric imitation, the same as Christ, as the trying to play Savior, is a cheap fabric imitation of the true Christ. However, he is supernatural. Never sell him short. But here he comes, trying to play Jesus, trying to play Savior. And he will arrive before the true Christ does. Christ will teach you that in this book of Revelation, as well as other places that we will make reference to as we continue in these seals. And actually, what we have here is the first seal of learning. What is the first seal of learning teaching you? That the false Christ comes first. And that will be made more obvious as we go along here. Now, as we move along, there is a time Christ would stipulate in Mark 13, hey, behold, I have foretold you all things. In other words, there's nothing should surprise you. He says, I've made these things available to you. Where was that at? Well, you'll find it written in the hold your place here. We're going to be dancing back and forth between Mark 13, where Christ will teach us seven things, which are the seven seals, the seven events, where they're no longer a mystery to you. And he's going to break it down whereby a child can understand. So we see then, here comes the white horse, looks like the Savior, got a crown on even, but he's a fake. It's the same as it is written in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Never worry about returning to Christ until after the son of perdition, that's this rider of the white horse, sits in the holy place claiming to be God or claiming to be Christ. It's going to happen first. He said, don't let our letter deceive you. Don't let some spirit or some preacher. You're not going anywhere until after this event transpires. So with that, let's go to the 13th chapter of Mark, and we're going to pick it up in the 5th verse. But remember what leads up to this 5th verse. Jesus was asked by the disciples, what's it going to be like at the second advent? What's it going to be like when you come back? Everybody, that's like asking, when is the end of the world going to happen and what will be happening then? This is what he answers, chapter 13, verse 5, great book of Mark, and it reads, and Jesus answered them, beginning to say, this is what he said about it, take heed lest any man deceive you. In other words, your first warning is deception. Your first warning is that people are going to be trying to deceive you. Primarily, number one is that rider of that fake horse. Not a fake horse, he's a fake on the horse. Looks real holy, got the big bow, only it's a cheap fabric imitation. Play actor, verse 6 of this 13th chapter of Mark reads, for many, not a few, many shall come in my name saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. That is to say, there's a lot of people going to come in the name of Christ. That means they're Christian preachers. I be one that represents Christ, the teacher of his holy word. So there you have it. Number one thing, don't be deceived. You must understand the chronological order of events. And with Revelation, meaning the unveiling, you had better know exactly what transpires, and that's what this is telling you. Let's go back, if we may, to that sixth chapter of Revelation, and sure enough, we see that we got one here coming, claiming to be Jesus. I'm Messiah, all right. That's what Satan always wanted to be. Revelation chapter 6, verse 3, and it reads, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see, the second living creature. Verse 4. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth. That means the rumor, wars and rumors of wars. And they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. Now, you want to remember that Esau was told that he would live by the sword, but that he would die by the sword way back into Genesis chapter 27. And we see who Satan, this rider, will utilize on today's map in part, and it really makes it quite interesting when you see what's happening there even at this time. Well, do you think Jesus would have followed that up in that 13th chapter of Mark? Well, let's go there and see. He said, this is what happens when I'm returning. Verse 7 of that 13th chapter of Mark, and it reads, and when you shall hear of wars and rumors of war, that be ye not troubled, for such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. Well, what's the opposite? What's the opposite of wars and rumors of wars? Peace, peace, peace. We got to make a peace treaty here. We got to make a peace treaty there. We got the United Nations to bring peace. We're going to bring in the new world order. Friend, you're there. Wake up. Smell the coffee. Smell the roses. You're there. It's happening. Let's return to the sixth chapter of Revelation, and we'll take verses 5 and 6. In verse 5 and 6 of Revelation 6 reads, and when he had opened the third seal, we're all the way down to the third one, I heard the third living creature beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. Now, and of course, balances means justice. It means black meaning famine, starving, and so forth. Starving for what would probably be the better idea? Starving for truth, because you got a liar riding the white horse. And verse 6 reads, and I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts, the four living creatures, say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil or the wine. Now, a denarius was a day's salary. What it meant was, a time's coming when you will work a full day for a loaf of bread, okay? And many are going to say, well, we're having good times now. Oh, are you? Are you really? Making lots of money, huh? Well, have you ever figured out when you, let's say your house payments, all right, for a large majority, you're making your house payment. Do you know what you do? They're pretty good size, aren't they? Well, yeah, but I'm able to do it. Oh, are you? Let me ask you a question. How much of it goes on principal? And that's like another way of saying, how much of it goes into your own pocket? Well, about 5%. Ooh. So you just get ripped off for 95% of it in usury. If you're lucky, you get 5%. Well, yeah, but it's my house. Yeah, yours and whose? Right? Think about it. I mean, you've got a jailer keeping you and keeping you in bondage, and he doesn't even have to have a guard to watch you. Beware of excessive usury, all right? It will cause you to work for maybe 5% of what you think you have if you're not real careful. We could add taxes and a bunch of other things in there, withholding taxes, city taxes, county taxes, and I wonder how much you'd have left then. Okay, well, anyway, well, would he have said anything about this famine and all this back in that Mark 13? Well, I don't know. Let's go there and see in verse 8. In verse 8 of Mark 13 reads, and nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in divers places, and there shall be famines, yep, there it is, and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. This word sorrows in the Greek is labor pains. The labor pains for what? The birth of the new age. Are you ready for it? The labor pains grow closer and closer together until that birth becomes a fact. So there you have it. But again, I must remind you that in Amos chapter 8, it stipulates there that the famine in the end times is not for bread, but for hearing the honest-to-God truth, the real Word of God. That's what the famine is for. You know, people are starving for truth in this world today, and you get so many deceivers that would tell them, you don't have to understand the book of Revelation, what it means, you're going to be gone. Well, that's just a big lie. That's all there is to it. It's just a big lie. That's not what Christ is saying. And he expects his people to have the knowledge that they do not find the temptation tempting, because they're not ignorant. They're familiar with God's word. That's why it's important that you let none of these things be a surprise to you. Let's return to the seventh verse of the sixth chapter of Revelation. And that seventh verse reads, and when he opened the fourth seal, now we're always to the four, already to the fourth, I heard the voice of the fourth beast, living creature, say, come and see, come and look. That means look with understanding too, my dear one. Verse 8, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse. That's death. And his name that sat on him was death. And hail followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beast of the earth. Now, this word beast here is not the living creature. This is literally therion, which means a poisonous, venomous beast. It's the beast system of the Kenite. It's the beast system that Satan has in place for those that are unlearned. But it's so religious. It looks so religious. Oh, does it? Well, Christianity is not a religion. It's a reality. Have you experienced the real thing? And we continue on here. Verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, let's go on with it, five of them, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. This is all the way back to the time of the disciples, where some of them were beheaded and so on and so forth. But, you know, you've got some preachers that will tell you, well, now God runs a parts store. The spirit goes back to the Father, but the soul stays in a hole in the ground. What does it say is under the altar of God here? Does it say spirits or souls? It says souls. The souls are there. God doesn't deal in parts. God deals in wholes. So don't ever let some idiot that would-be preacher tell you that just a certain part of you goes back to the Father at death. The whole being, your soul would better, I like to translate it for simplicity, self, your very being. Your spirit is only the intellect of the soul, and naturally, the intellect must go with the soul. It's impossible for the intellect to move around by its own, because it must have a self or soul to think with or within, better said. But they died for the testimony. All right, that pretty well narrows down who we're talking about here, does it not? But the thing being, they're not in a hole in the ground. No one is. They're all there. Some of them on the opposite side of the gulf, yes. But they're all there waiting for judgment. Verse 10. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? Well, it's obvious they shed their blood on the earth, that they were persecuted here. It really does. It makes it very obvious. Verse 11, and white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet a little season until their fellow servants, now let that settle in your mind, fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. Now, we're going to be delivered up to death, which is Satan. A spiritual death would be there for many, but not for you. Don't ever think for a moment that once you learn the truth, that you can be sucked into the deception spewed out by many that come and say, I be a Christian teaching Christian works. It better be the Word of God, and it better be all of it, or he's a fake. Christ makes all things known. That's why we call this the book of Revelation, the unveiling, whereby you would not be caught short. Well, I wonder if Christ told us back in Mark 13 what this is talking about. Well, of course he did. Let's go there and pick it up with verse 9 about those being delivered up for that testimony. Testimony in verse 9, while your fellow servants should be delivered up for that testimony. What does it say here in verse 9 of the 13th chapter of Mark? But take heed to yourselves. You be very careful. For they shall deliver you up to councils, that Sanhedrins, and in the synagogues. Whose synagogues? Satan's, of course. Ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake. For whose sake? Yours? Somebody else's? No, for Christ's sake. That's to be browbeaten, if you would. I don't know, how sharp are you when somebody begins to browbeat you? I hope you can cut them off just about the knees. I hope you're sharp enough in the Word of God that you can give them an education quickly. For my sake, for a testimony against them. Now, I assure you, that makes Satan's little characters very unhappy when you begin to witness against them. And quite frankly, it is written in Luke chapter 21, which is a side profile of this teaching that we're doing here. It stipulates there that not even the gainsayers can argue with what you say at that time. And there's a very special reason for that. Because what do you say at that time? Verse 10. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. That's the purpose. The real purpose. Verse 11. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do you premeditate. But whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, what hour? The hour of temptation. That speak ye, for it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost. And naturally, understandably so, that is why they will be convinced at that time. They cannot help but be convinced, because again, it isn't you that speak. Do you know what this is an example of? This is what Peter was talking about in Acts chapter 2 when he said, this is what Joel the prophet spoke of. This is that Joel taught. When both the sons and the daughters began to speak on Pentecost Day in a tongue that was not unknown, but quite the contrary, was understood in every language of the world all at the same time. Needed no interpreter. That, my dear friend, is the evidence of the presence of the Holy Spirit. If you hear some gobbledygook going on without, and it's not clear to your ear, it wasn't the tongue spoken on Pentecost Day. Acts chapter 2, verses 6 and 7 will document that. If you have a mind, it will. But that's the time that both sons and daughters will begin to witness, as it is written by Joel the prophet, and also in Acts chapter 2. What will happen? Verse 12. Now the brother shall betray the brother to death, and the father the son. And children shall rise up against their parents, and shall cause them to be put to death. Satan is death. He is the rider of the white horse that sits there claiming to be Christ. And your dear little brothers and sisters who believe in the rapture doctrine will already have thought he is Jesus come to fly him away, because that's what he teaches. This is why God himself said, I'm against those in Ezekiel 13 that teach my people to fly to save their souls. I'm against them, and he is. Now, I know I may upset some, but I would rather upset you a little bit than to see your soul burn in hell because you've been deceived by some saying, I come in the name of Jesus. Well, does he give you one verse and then pop hot air for an hour? Or does he teach God's word whereby you clearly understand? For the famine in the end times is not for bread, but for hearing God's word taught properly. Well, why, pray tell me why, would a father deliver his own son up to death? Well, if he believes in the rapture doctrine and this false pony rides up, do you know what he's going to say to this rider? Oh, Jesus, my boy is really a good boy. Will you save him? Touch him, Jesus. Because he thinks you are the Antichrist. Would you please talk to him? He's really been a good boy all his life. He's just a little confused because he's studied the Bible too much. He won't listen to Brother Popoff. Brother Popoff has told us that you would be here to fly us away, and we didn't have to understand the book of Revelation. We'll be gone. There's just one problem. Brother Popoff is lying to you. The word rapture is not even in the Bible. Nowhere. Nada. Zippo. A lot of people will try to whip it up and conjure it up from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, but the subject and the object is, where are the dead? Paul stipulates, can you read English? It stipulates in verse 13, I do not want you to be ignorant like the heathen, for if you believe Christ rose from the dead, you had better believe that your brothers and sisters have risen also. They're not out there in a hole in the ground. And at the seventh trump, the last, we're all going to gather back to him. In the air, the Greek is spirit, a breath of life body, which is your spiritual body, changed instantly in the twinkle of an eye. Don't let man con you. Don't let man rob you of this beautiful word written by Messiah. No, a mother would not deliver a daughter up to death unless she thought she was talking to Jesus and the daughter refused her Jesus. There's just one problem. Her Jesus is a fake. This is the false Christ. You know, Antichrist means instead of Christ. Check it out for yourself. Take your Strong's Concordance and break it back to the Greek. You'll find it means instead of. It's Satan standing there instead of the real Jesus. Have you been taught that? Well, do it for yourself and find out. And we're going to pick this up in the next lecture. I do not like to stop here in this place, but we must for the sake of time. Don't you forget a word that has been stated in this lecture. For the conclusion of this lecture will be in the next broadcast. Don't you dare miss it. It is so very important for you to know what happens just before the true Christ returns, because you're seeing much of it go on right today. Have you recognized it? Well, then, if you haven't, then that's not a sin. But it's a sin to not study to know the next day what's in store, okay? Do not be biblically illiterate. Don't listen to some man. Get into the Word of God. It's so very important. And you should know and understand. You don't have to memorize it, but know and understand the totality of God's word as best you can, whereby you understand the flow of his plan. All right, we'll pick it up in the next lecture. You be here with us. Listen a moment, won't you please?